התרבות והם זה לא משהו ש...
Thank you.
Come a little bit closer because we're going to be here. We're going to have a short introduction and announcement there.
Yeah, come on.
Here's the best, right?
Yeah. Okay. Sorry, it should be okay. If you say that side of the face, that would be ideal. Thanks.
Feel the Just before we started, actually. But before I'm finishing, I would like to thank quite a few organizations that helped us here. First of all, the Art Council England, that without their support, all this massive exhibition and the festival didn't happen. And of course, Phoenix Gallery, Cass Art, that supported us really generously with art materials. And families, friends, and of course, supporting artists. So thank you very much and enjoy the second day. Thank you.
Thanks, Ron. Hello, I'm Elizabeth Thomas. The piece you're seeing this evening, this afternoon, is called Vibrant Matter. I just want to introduce the amazing performers who are working with me today. So in the yellow corner, we have Agatha. In the magenta, this is Anna. And in the blue, this is Yayan, who've worked with me this year on various projects and have kindly agreed to be here today. After I finish speaking, we probably won't speak then until the end. But you will see that there's some communication going on between us. We are a tiny little bit behind where we wanted to be before you arrived, just because setting this up takes a while. So just bear with us for probably a few more minutes, and then you'll start to see things begin to emerge. So this is a large amount of difference for George. Okay. See you the other side.
So you're most welcome to come closer to the work, and we want to ask you guys questions.
Yes, of course. Started working together on what would happen if it was three performers and if the characters moved around, and that's how Vibrant Matter was born. So this is the inaugural performance, it's the first time it's been performed in front of anyone.
So I think one of you are dance oriented?
You are.
Yeah, I've danced at the age of seven but never with any technique. So a little bit chaotic.
And the other one, what are you
doing? I like to dance in general, but I never did any classes.
So you're studying
fine arts. So we did movement workshops as part of the laboratory. So it was basically three sessions, wasn't it? It was really fast. So we did three Wednesday afternoons where I kind of slammed them through, like, what does it mean to be a performer? What kinds of things do you need to know how to do? There's movement, vocal coaching. And we did some movement as part of that, and that is what the movement you saw came out of. So one of the tasks that we did as part of that was called floor solos, which is kind of what you're seeing here, which is all about how you have a relationship with the floor and you let the contact with the floor kind of lead what you do with your body. So this is entirely improvised, although we have rehearsed. What you're seeing is brand new in the moment every time.
We have to say that you practiced the dance quite a lot.
Yeah, so I did dance from being three, and I went to dance and drama school alongside normal school, and I was in a young people's dance company into my early 20s, I developed a disability in just before lockdown that now I can still move, but it's more difficult for me than it once was. And so that's also part of the reason for moving towards using other performers, because I'm slightly more limited now in what I can do. So that's a bit of a shift for me in my own practice, because everything before this was my own body. So it's a bit of a shift in what I'm doing. But yes, I've had that.
And you sculpting?
Oh yes, my metalworks. Who I've intoxicated with performance skills, and now he won't leave, which is amazing.
Any other question for?
Yeah, I'm really fascinated by this interface between dance and drawing. So I was just wondering, that while you were doing your movements, were you thinking about the imprint on the paper, where your body is going to leave more print? Were you kind of keen to leave as much print as possible, or where was your, where were your thoughts then?
So when I'm doing it, I'm wanting to sort of leave like quite a strong line is what I try to do. So I try to put. I try and use quite a lot of my weight on a particular pressure point to try and sort of like...
Probably those are your marks.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I sort of focus on trying to put as much sort of body weight and pressure on a single point at a particular time to make a mark.
Each of their movements is kind of really unique as well. So like one of the reasons I really liked working with Yaya and I asked him to do this is you probably notice he's really good at lifting his body off the paper and contorting. Anna has this amazing thing that she does with her hands, you saw that. And then Agata has, like, it's very sensuous in the way that she moves, and she's like really using her head and her back. So each of them had kind of different characteristics that I thought was interesting. And that's kind of why I thought, because then it becomes almost like they're the colours as well. So they're different notes.
Well, there is a beautiful image when you actually have your head and nose pressed against the paper, which is, I found it like really unique. I mean, like kind of going into it in a way, even though it's just.
Well, I know
there's
probably not intended at all because you're not discussed that, but I really got this kind of reflection on the pandemic, staying at home, being inside a little bit square and put on your body and just. How can you move inside this kind of square where you don't have more space?
You were thinking about it without knowing that it's sort of like related to the pandemic?
Yeah, because that's exactly what I was doing. So I was in my tiny studio trying to like figure out how I could move, so that's exactly where it was. University of OS and so on, then we maybe make it so I wasn't necessarily having to queue as much. But for me, one of the things that was nice about that is I remember when we first came out of the pandemic, those first moments of contact with people, and they were kind of tentative and uncertain, you weren't quite sure what the relationship was. And so I think for me, when I was coming in to be like, okay, you can leave now or whatever, but it was something about like waiting to make eye contact was really important, because like bringing them out of that space of isolation. So I would try and like wait until I've caught their gaze, and then, okay, now we go, now we move. So that was a kind of intention for me, I swear.
Yes, I found that very interesting, the way that you were doing the I have to slow down the relevance between the new cues.
I mean, all of my research, all of my practice, I'm really interested in contact. So contact improvisation, which is a method of dance movement anyway. So one of the things I always think about in my practice is the idea that everything that I'm working with is an improvisational partner with me. They're a collaborator. The rollers, the inks, the plates, everything. We're all intermingled in a sort of quantum atomic way. It's all part of the same thing. So I suppose for me, in developing the idea of it coming to the floor, there's something of that energy coming through the floor into the performer. There's a kind of moment of contact that happens there. So I think always, whenever I'm doing anything, I'm always trying to think about how does one make contact with something or someone. So those are people who were in my
workshop this morning, we were talking a lot about how you give time and care to objects. So one of the things I do with contact printmaking is a method of taking prints from 3D objects, but you really have to spend time with the object for that to work. So there's a sense in which you give of yourself into that object and it gives back to you. One of my other pieces of work is a really massive screen printing machine, which is in the process of being built. And again, it's a partner. It has agency on me, I have agency on it. So it's all kind of
I
expected something very, in a way, deterministic, that we would see really explicitly faces. And I was surprised because first, the faces are a bit dim, so a bit, not necessarily so legible. And also what I like is that there is noise and randomness in it, especially with those grainings and this unexpected. So I like the fact that it combines in a way the kind of loss of control about what is made, which is, it's not exactly a copy of
yes.
the, and you couldn't reveal the gesture from the traces. It's totally
every single time we do this, the prints are totally different. I was thinking about, and also they're a surprise to me, because I don't know what's going to happen until they come off. So even when we first pulled them, even the first one, where it's just one color, I can see straight away they're totally different from the ones we made together in the hassle, and they look utterly different. And we've done exactly the same thing, more or less, in the, you know, the ink's the same and so on. But that's just the agency of these things. They collect dust. The heat will have changed things. They'll be morphing. So they are as much a partner as we are.
So you're sure you will have variations when you make them, you're sure?
And I kind of like that because one of the things people go on about with printmaking is that it's reproductive capability. I really like messing with that. So there is nothing reproductive about this in any way.
When you peel it off, it's so satisfying.
Yeah,
it's like a giant sweet.
It feels amazing as well, doesn't it? Like, yeah, it pulls, so you really have to kind of tug it. And this paper's quite soft, so it kind of like responds to the pressure.
Just a couple of points. First, what was the reason behind these colors? And secondly, I don't know if obviously you know this, you've got some high density spots, maybe total round, whereas you use the roll to flatten them out.
Why did that happen? Good question.
Well, I mean, it looks beautiful.
I
kind of
like it. Yeah. So in printmaking, we actually call that noise. That is the technical term for it.
For noise.
It's called noise. Essentially, the purpose of the rolling out on the glass that you saw before is to limit noise. That's what a printmaker would normally be doing it for. Because obviously, if you're printing something that is representative of a particular image, you don't want noise in the image, right? I continue to do that anyway, even though it doesn't matter to us, just because if you can get a slightly flatter consistency of ink before you start, it's easier. Basically, you'll get a better mark. But we don't worry overly about being super precious about it. I mean, you'll notice that like we're trying to be careful that we're going in the same direction,
right,
and so on and so forth. But it doesn't really matter. In terms of the colours, again, sorry, everything is print referential. I'm just obsessed with print. So it's because these are the colours that you use in the four colour separation process. So if you take a photograph and you want to make it into a screen print, take it into Photoshop, you separate it into cyan, magenta, yellow, and black. And we haven't got black here, obviously. And then you rebuild the print, yellow first, magenta, cyan, black.
That's,
and then that pulls it back together.
Yeah, but that's for the printing, because usually it's RGB for the lighting.
For printing, it's CMYK.
Yeah.
And I love what the colors do to each other.
RGB is more for additive colors.
All right, okay.
Printing is more by subtractive colors. So
okay.
I have done these with the black as well, but I find that because the purpose of the black is to pull the image back together, if you were making an image, I find that black deadens these, flattens them, and I don't like it. So it's CMY minus the K. K is absent.
Sorry, my last question, but then you show this one against the light. So I'm now wondering, so what's the final piece? This, which goes against that, or that?
Everybody asked me that.
Sorry.
Both.
I'm both. Both. Yes,
both. No, it's good. It's funny. Both. I think the reason I pay more attention to the plates is, one of the things I'm really interested in at the moment, and I do not profess to understand this entirely, but I've really lately been reading a lot of quantum mechanics and quantum physics stuff,
right.
New materialism as well,
right.
Which
very
basically
nice arguments. Yeah.
Yeah. But anyway, one of the things that they talk about in new materialism is the attention to matter,
right.
And you can really see it on the plate because it collects all the dust. So as soon as you put it in front of the light, you suddenly get that kind of sense of the atoms that are going on the pigments. So there's something about that feels important to me.
Yeah.
And also again, it's probably a printmaking thing. The plates get discarded. They're so often not. It's like, oh, we're done with that. This is the thing that matters. But actually, I always think plates are more, they hold something.
Oh, yeah.
So I like to give value to the thing that would normally not be given value.
Sure. Yeah. This is perspex.
Yeah, they literally matter. They matter. Yeah. They're builders glazing.
Glaze, okay.
Yeah. So it's when you're building a house and you need to make sure it's waterproof before you get the proper glass in, you put these in.
Yeah.
So they love me a bit, because
I'm
like,
yeah.
Clearly I need to buy these.
I didn't know you.
I think they think my house is kind of construction company. I was really bad at glazing.
Oh. Okay, guys. Sorry to break it down, but we are running late. Thank you very much. Yes, we will take, so it's 7:05. We will take, we will come back to hear it at 7:15, if it's okay. And we'll prepare before for the second performance. Thank you very much.
Yeah. do you fancy same beer?
Yeah.
You don't stay here?
Thank you.
Thank you.
storm. If you didn't understand it. Okay, cheers. Thanks. Participated. Anyway, thanks very much and see you next week.